everyone. Thank you. I'm Yakir from Premium Services, and today I'm going to show you three design patterns that will help you create more reusable components in React. This is an advanced talk in React, so if you're new to React, you might struggle a little bit with the code examples, but be strong, it's worth it. I was told to introduce myself, so that's me. I'm a geek, basically, and beside that, I also like to travel with my wife, snowboarding, and CrossFit for the past year and a half, almost. I've been in Wix for the past 2.5 years, and I'm programming in React for 3 years now, and 6 years as a web developer. Sorry, web developer, more or less. Okay, so let's begin. We like to reuse code, and part of why React is such a successful framework is its powerful composition model. But writing truly reusable React component is hard because our requirements are changing over time. The patterns we're going to see today will help us create flexible API for our components. And by that, I mean that our component will be easier to reuse, but also flexible enough to support more complex use cases. So let's begin with a typical component lifecycle. And it's not what you think. So we wrote this cool component, and now we want to reuse it. But not exactly. It needs to look a little different. This one is rendering a tooltip, for example. So we add some props to it, and then some more props. And each time we do that, our component is becoming more complex to use and also more complex to maintain. Inside the render function is starting to fill with all those if statements and switch cases until it explodes. Do you think a component like this is reusable? Personally, I'm not so sure because it looks like every time we want to reuse it, we need to add more props to it. So we're going to explore some ways today to see how we can make this mess a little easier and make our component truly reusable and flexible. These are the patterns we're going to see today. Render prop, state reducer, and compound components. So let's start with a render prop. I'm going to show you some props, and yeah, it's an exercise. I'm going to show you some props, and you tell me what they have in common. Placeholder, clear button, round input. Anyone has a clue? Sorry? Content, visual, yeah. It's about these props are controlling what our component is rendering. So basically, we give our component some props. It returns JSX. And that's how React knows what to render, right? What this means is that our component is controlling all of the props. And in order for us to change something in what is rendering, sorry, it controls all of the rendering. And in order for us to change something in what it's rendering, it needs to open up all these different props to us, and we need to pinpoint exactly what we want to change. With render prop, we're using a principle called inversion of control to help gain back control of what we are rendering. This is how it looks like. Basically, instead of all these props, we're passing a function to our component, and the component is calling our function. This is the inversion of control. And inside this function, whatever we return, this is what will be rendered to the screen. So let's see how it looks like in code. Basically, we pass a function instead of all these different props, and inside here, we get the arguments from our components, and we also have access to our own state and props. And whatever we return here, it what will be rendered to the screen. You can remember it by that we're making our component more flexible by surrendering the render. Now let's see some code. Okay, so I wrote this very original component. It's a counter, and you can see that it works. And now I want to add all these props to it so I can reuse it somewhere else. For example, it needs to support right to left. It needs to support vertical orientation because our UI may be maybe cluttered sometime. And you can see that right now these two props already create some mess in our code because it creates some impossible state, for example. It's something we may be overcome in some ways, but this example here is here to show you the problem of all of these different props we're adding. Then we wanted a custom input element, so no problem. And maybe changing the size. This one was easy, it's basically CSS. Cool. Now let's look at a render method. It's quite complex, and I do a lot of code reviews. When I see a method like this, it normally tells me it's an indication that maybe we need some refactoring here because this component is doing too much. This render function is already too complicated. So the developer who wrote this decided to extract some code outside. And now, why not to extract it to a different component? And it's also quite sad on the left and on the right. So let's see how we solve all these problems with render prop. So this is the render prop implementation right here. We can see that we extracted outside all of the logic for our code. And basically all we do is managing the state of our counter. And now we call our children as a function right here, providing it the arguments of the state and the method to change the states. And the usage looks like this. And inside here, we have the flexibility to change our component and whatever it renders. For example, now it's right to left. If we can add a div here, and we're going to see it in some weird vertical orientation that we'll fix in CSS later, but we can ship it, right? It's kind of cool. Any questions about render prop? Cool. So let's move on. State reducer is the next pattern we'll see. Again, another exercise. Props, and tell me what they have in common.
Behavior?
Yes, behavior, state. Exactly, this is a props that we use to control our component and tell it how to react to events and how to behave. Same thing, normal flow. We have this common dilemma with when we're writing a component, do we want our component to be controlled or uncontrolled? Uncontrolled component have the advantage that they are fairly easy to use, but they're not so flexible because, well, we can't control them. And control component are much more flexible, but they come with a lot of work. We need to listen to event handlers. We need to manage a state. It's a lot of code we can't share. So maybe we can use the same principles of inversion of control to help us reduce the amount of props we need in order to use this component and reuse logic that is logic, actually. What if our component could tell us, hey, this event happened and I calculated this new state. Do you want to change it? So this is a reducer function. This is a state reducer. Again, we pass a function to our component instead of all the different props. And inside And whenever the state of the component change, it tells us the change happened, and what is our current full state, and what are the changes. And we can decide if we want to override it or not. Let's see how it looks like in a simple code example. So if it's familiar to you, it's because it's very similar to a Redux reducer. But the events are a little, the arguments are a little different. Here, we get the current full state of our component, and these are the changes that we want to apply. And we can switch change over the change type and decide if we want to override it or not. Simply returning the change object will result in the component behaving in the same way, in the default behavior. Again, let's see some code. The implementation of our counter is a little bit different now. We need to declare all the different changes we have, state changes we have in our component, so that we don't have to repeat this string in every state reducer we use. Now our increment and decrement methods are different. They don't call set state directly. Instead, they call a helper method that and tell it what we are changing and what is the change type. So for example, here we're increasing the counter by one when the button is clicked. Change count basically calls set state. We get the current full state. We calculate our changes, and we decide if we have a state reducer, we call it with the full current state. Remember, we're inside set state, and we give it the second argument, which is the changes and the type of the change. Whatever the state reducer will return to us will be our new state. So I used the same example from before with the render prop, but it doesn't have to be. They're not dependent. And you can see that the counter I made is now behaving a little different. When we go above 10, we start increasing faster in steps of 5 and also decreasing. Sorry, I forgot to mention that here we pass a state reducer to our counter. And let's see the implementation of this state reducer. If our count is lower than 10, then we simply ignore it. We default to the regular behavior. And this is the switch case where we say if we're clicking the increasing button and we are above 10, then increase by 5. Otherwise, decrease by 5. Any questions about that? So the patterns we've seen right now, they're powerful patterns, but when we're using them, it might introduce some boilerplate to our code. So I think they play well as a low-level API for our code, and we can use it to We can use those patterns to build a low-level API which is flexible and extensible, and above that, build a more simple API for the common use cases. And advanced use cases could use the low-level API, more complex use cases. The last pattern I'll show you today is compound component. And it's a pattern that we can use if we actually don't need all this freedom in our app. For example, here in Wix, we have a design system, and we want to limit the amount of freedom a developer has, so our users, our actual users, will have the same experience all across our website. So with compound component, we gain a much simpler API for our component, but and we're trading the freedom of render prop for a simpler API for our component. This is how it looks like. So again, imagine a component that is built from a set of subcomponents. For example, an autocomplete. It has an input button, text input, and some pop-up menu with the items, and maybe a toggle button. And then we need to control the behavior of all these components through props. But maybe we can actually, instead of imperatively transfer all this data and make our component convert it to CSS, to JSX, we can actually declare those components. And this way we can be more specific about what we want to render without increasing the complexity of our API. So compound components are basically a set of subcomponents that are shipped with our main component, and we pass them back to the main component as children. And I'll show you an example. Here we see our counter again. We attached all the different components that can be used in our counter. And the implementation is pretty much similar to the implementation of the render prop, but by what we are doing here. And this component now becomes a context provider for the state and the methods to change that state. We basically render the children inside, and each child is a context consumer. Let's look at this example. This is a classic context consumer, and inside we can render what we want based on that context. And the usage looks like this. We have the freedom to render whatever we want here and change it. And everything still works. And we can also introduce new components. For example, the input. And we're not increasing the complexity of our component or its API. We simply wrote another component right here. Thank you. I also think it's really, really cool. Any questions about that? Okay. I first encountered the power of these patterns in a library called Downshift. Downshift is an autocomplete that doesn't render anything. Instead, it takes control over the complex events and state changes of an autocomplete component, and you decide what to render. Downshift supports all these different behaviors and more use cases and more. Basically, what you get is an ARIA compliant autocomplete that is fully accessible and with all the mouse and keyboard events, and you have complete control of how it looks like, and you can customize its behavior with a state reducer. You may ask yourself, what about hooks? So, no presentation in 2019 that is about React is complete without a hook example, right? So there's some good news and some bad news for some of these props. Render prop is probably, I think we're going to see less of that, because render prop is about separating our UI logic from our state. And hooks do this very well. This is why, personally, I think hooks are so cool. And they also compose better. And state reducer can actually be used alongside with hooks. So it's actually a little easier to use and to customize our hooks. And compound components are actually a lot more fun to use right now because using context is super easy right now with hooks, which is great. Another example. Let's not go too much into this code here. You can see that now instead of all the indirection we have with render prop, we can simply have a use counter hook, which is a custom hook. And that's it. We get all the logic we want, and we have the freedom to render it whatever we want. Same counter still works. We can make our hook accept a state reducer to change the behavior the way we've seen before. And if you're familiar with the use reducer hook, so the context is pretty similar. It's almost like combining reducers. And as we've seen in the compound example, hooks replace this code with this code, which it's always fun to write less code, right? In order to accomplish the same job. Okay, you may found the examples I show you today, those buttons. You may think that you can only use them in libraries such as Downshift or Weak Style React, but I disagree. I actually used some of those patterns in two components I wrote, and I want to show them to you now. About a year ago, in Premium, we started to convert all our different purchase flow from Angular to React, and I was assigned to write the first purchase flow, which is the mailbox purchase flow, and when I got the mock from my designer, I saw a component that wasn't in our design system, so I needed to implement it. It's this navigation stepper you see here. Basically, it tells the user where they are in the context of in the purchase flow, what they need to do in order to complete the purchase flow. And so I wrote this component. I wrote a naive implementation of it, and we shipped the product. We won the A/B test. It was cool, basically picking up money off the floor. That's why Premium is so fun. And we knew that there are going to be more purchase flows, and we're going to need to reuse this component, but we didn't know exactly what to expect. So during Guild Week, me and my partner, for the Guild Week, we rewrote this component. We extracted the logic out using render prop. And above that, we built a nice API that uses compound components, and it's more opinionated and is more related to use case. And it turned out to be a great success because you can see for yourself, this is the second purchase flow, the planned purchase flow. And up above, this is the same nav stepper. It's fixed to the screen, and it has some disabled tabs that it's a requirement that was pretty easy to support without changing the API of our component. The second component I want to show you is the order page container. It's this form that we use to take the credit card details from our users. And it's a pretty complex component, and it's a React component that wraps an iframe, and we use it in our purchase flows, in a React purchase flow, and that's the API of it right now. It was fun. It was fine for a time because we on premium, we know what we need to give to this component in order to use it. But Wix is changing and growing, and more companies now want to sell things and have their own purchase flows. And we want them to reuse our component. We want them to use it. So now we're working on a new API for this component, which looks like this. Yeah, you see, it's now should be a lot simpler for a developer outside of Premium to use it. Basically, all you need to tell it is what you want to sell right here, and inside we give you the freedom to render whatever you want, which I think is very cool. I want to show you one last example if I didn't convince you this far. I basically took the same counter we saw in state reducer. We saw in the state reducer example. The only thing I added to it is keyboard events. Keyboard events, and I customized it. Here I used buttons from Material UI, and it supports all these different look and behavior. Without actually, I didn't change almost anything in this component. And here we see a complex example that uses a state reducer that whatever I increase here is what the steps will be on this counter. And now, if someone wants to use my counter, they can use whatever version of it they want. And they don't, for example, if they don't need Material UI, then they won't get all the, it won't bundle into their code. Webpack can tree shake it. And I can continue and add more and more and build more and more on top of it without increasing its complexity or changing its API. Okay, I hope that the pattern I show you today will help you create a more flexible API for your component. But remember that the point here is to reduce the amount of work from you as a developer and from the developer that use your component. So if all you ever going to need is a counter with minimum and maximum values, then you probably don't need a state reducer. When you design the API of your component, it's important to think about what your users need to know in order to use it. And remember that finding the best API for your component is hard, and for any API for any problem for that matter. So don't get attached to your code or the patterns in it. They are just more tools in your toolbox. Thank you.